So if we look at the principal stress space, think of a space sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, where these are the principal stresses. And you can always get the principal stresses from a full stress tensor of stresses, right? So you can have a tensor, general tensor sigma, sigma 1, 1, sigma 1, 2, sigma 1, 3, sigma 2, 2, sigma 2, 3, sigma 3, 3, right? And the rest is just symmetric, right? You can always get the principal stresses of these, right? Sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. Always. That's a given. So for any stress sigma, we can always get that. And then we can play to plot those states of stress in this stress space. So I'm going to be speaking up a lot about this stress space, right? Because that's, in a way, what's going to determine the state of stress of a point. So in this stress space, there are several things that are worth mentioning. There is a line that we're going to be talking about over and over again, that we're going to be calling the hydrostatic axis. Okay, this line is defined by sigma 1 equal to sigma 2 equal to sigma 3. Okay, that's a mathematical representation of that. Now, imagine a plane such that it is orthogonal. So this plane here, this plane, okay, it's orthogonal to the hydrostatic axis. Okay, and maybe in your notes you can draw it better. And it's also cutting through the origin. Okay, so if you use your imagination a little bit, okay, you have an infinite number of planes that are orthogonal to the hydrostatic axis, but only one such plane that also goes through the origin. Okay, so this is a plane, and that's almost impossible to draw here in 2D. That is perpendicular. To the hydrostatic axis, okay, and goes through origin. In other words, 0, 0, 0, 1, right? This point, this is the sigma 1, sigma 2 equals sigma 3. Line. Okay, so that is the full definition of a plane. That such plane, and only that plane, is called a pipe.
Where do you want to put this stuff? Maybe you can skip or go faster.
Okay.
Hey.
No.
Okay.
Okay. Because that's the lecture notes I have. So.
All right, right. Okay. No, I was just suggesting.
all right. So you go through the origin, and you call that the pi plane. Any other plane, it's typically called a deviatory plane. Okay, so the pi plane is a deviatory plane. But only the pipeline goes through the origin. Good. So if you look at another angle, you get, so that's sigma, no, this is sigma 3, and this is sigma 1, sigma 2. This is the hydrostatic axis. Okay, the pipeline, you would see it here, right? And that's a hydrostatic axis. You can define an angle here, theta, which is the same as this angle. Okay, and then you can define other things like if this distance to here is square root of 2, this distance here is 1. This distance here would be square root of 3. Why? Because there, you know, you can, the projection of the hydrostatic axis onto the sigma 1, sigma 2, so if this is 1, yeah, so if this is 1, this here, this distance, this point here would be square root of 2, of course. And then if you hit the hydrostatic line here, this distance here would be square root of 3. So that's what I'm drawing here. So this is square root of 3, this is square root of 2, right? This is 1. Okay, so then you get that cosine of theta, of this angle, from which the hydrostatic axis spans from sigma 3, is equal to 1 over square root of 3. Or roughly 54.7.
Question.
Yes.
So is the bottom axis there like sigma 1 equals sigma 2?
It could be, yeah, yeah. It could be equal, yeah, yeah. Sure, yeah. That is, yeah, you could make it this, exactly this axis. That's it. Okay, so we've defined this. So we are saying that there exists a plane such that sigma 1 equals sigma 2, no, sorry, sigma 1 plus sigma 2 plus sigma 3 equals 0. This is our pi plane. Okay, this is the pi plane. And this guy has a normal vector n hat equal to 1 over root 3, 1 over root 3, 1 over root 3. So it's this is n, right? N hat is here. And it's perpendicular to the pipe. So far, so good, right? So it's pretty straightforward. Then something we do quite a bit in plasticity for many reasons is sometimes we are interested in understanding the projection of something onto the pipe plane. And many times, something that's important is a particular value of sigma 3 and how much that will be when that is projected to the pi plane, okay? So you can see that there's a geometrical relationship. In particular, if this is theta, this angle here will be pi minus theta, right, or 90, pi over 2, I'm sorry. So 90 degrees minus theta. So the relationship between sigma 3 and what we're going to be calling sigma 3 super pi, right, is given by trigonometry. So, right, so it would be cosine of 90 minus theta equals sigma 3 pi over sigma 3. And this can be written as sine
of theta, if I'm not mistaken, right? And then this is a multiplier for sigma 3, and that is equal to sigma 3 pi. Okay, so sine of pi is about, well, it's here. It's sine of theta, right? If this is theta, then your sine of theta is root 2 over root 3. So sigma 3 root 2 over root 3 equals sigma 3 pi. And in numbers, this is about 0.82 sigma 3. So, okay, as you can see, you always get a distortion that seems to give you a sigma 3 pi that is slightly less than what you have in sigma 3. Okay, this is all geometry. Okay, so geometry in multi-D will become extremely important because we're going to be drawing a lot. We're going to be interpreting many things geometrically, and geometry is the only way that you can debug your codes, okay? Yes?
So sigma 3 pi is measured along the pi plane, so to speak.
Yeah. Okay. Right. It's this distance, right, from here.
Right.
To here. So if this distance looks like, or is 1, then this distance will be 0.2, slightly less. And again, what will differentiate good plasticity models from not so good plasticity models is this understanding of the geometry. And when you really understand the geometry, you can debug very easily. You can really understand if your code is doing what it's supposed to be doing, as opposed to just spitting values. Yeah.
What's the importance of the hydrostatic axis? It seems like it's like a special case of a principal stress state. If we're not hydrostatic, we'd be anywhere else? Is there still a pi plane?
You can be anywhere you want, but a lot of the plasticity models will have at least an initial state that is centered in the hydrostatic axis. And the reason for that is that most of your initial states are isotropic, right? Let's say a zero state of stress is here and it happens to be isotropic, or, you know, even 100 kPa would be here, but that's without having any shear stress. So the hydrostatic axis is a very special state, if you will. The other thing is that later on we'll see that most models split states of stress between hydrostatic and non-hydrostatic. So it's a way to manipulate something that is more complex in 3D with something that is simple in 2D. That's why I'm saying that the geometry plays a great role, because only when you can boil things down to, say, 2D and interpret the geometry, you can really see if your code is doing what it's supposed to be doing. Most people I see that make mistakes with plasticity, they want to live here. They stick with this. And here it's very difficult to see what's going on. Very difficult. Our minds are coded to, well, even our retina is trained to see things in a plane, okay? And then the brain is able to process that to make it 3D. But so the 3D interpretation of images is extremely difficult, especially when things are complex. So there is this J2 yield criterion. That is the most famous plasticity model out there. It's the most classic, most celebrated yield criterion. It's the one that was invented for metals a succession of models. I'll show you some models. So there's a J2, then I'll show you the Tresca model. So J2 is attributed to von Mises. The Tresca model, obviously, is attributed to Tresca. And they were invented to simulate the behavior of materials, of metals. So they have their origins in metals. Actually, plasticity has its origin in metals. And we're going to be using here the classic decomposition that you probably learned in in continuum mechanics, didn't you, that you can always split a stress tensor into volumetric and liberatoric stresses? Is that right? Okay. So this is your volumetric component of stress. Well, I'm just going to be calling it volumetric stress. This is your liberatoric. Okay, going back to Jason's question again. So sigma V, at least its norm or some sort of measurement of sigma V, will always lie along the hydrostatic axis, and S, or a norm of S, will always lie perpendicular to that. So, okay. So sigma V, here we define it as a definition. Is what's called an invariant, is one-third of a trace of sigma, or if you like direct notation, one-third of sigma double contracted with the identity, right? Where the identity one is just your classic identity, or in conditional notation, 1ij, right? Some people call it delta. I sometimes call it delta, I sometimes call it one. It doesn't matter. Okay, it's just a name. Okay, but its property, right, is that it's equal to one when I equals j, and zero when I not equal j. Okay, it's a chronic algorithm.
Don't you need an identity right there?
What?
Sigma b.
Ah, yes. Yes, good, thank you. Here, and I need more. Here, too, thanks. Yeah. To make it a tensor. So let's just use. So trace sigma is a scalar, and then what makes it a tensor is the one. Okay, so we sometimes call V's, which is equal to V's, P, or pressure. And you would see that quite a bit in models, okay? So the dimension or the length or the norm or the strength, if you will, of sigma V is given by P, and then the direction is given by 1, okay? The magnitude of 1 is always 1. All right, then S is whatever P or sigma V didn't take. Okay, let's just be consistent. So, and its property is that the trace of S or S double contracted with 1 is always zero. Right? So this is the liberatoric property. Have you seen this before?
Yes, okay.
Every tensor that is traceless, it's by definition a liberatoric tensor. All right. So far so good. Okay. Yield function J2 is a function of sigma and some plastic internal variable kappa. Okay, very same structure as in 1D. This is equal to the L2 norm of S minus kappa equals zero. I mean, you can see this as sigma minus sigma y equals zero. Okay, now we're just talking about 3D. Okay, so things are slightly different, where the L2 norm of S is, as always, defined as, well, let's do it in direct notation, S double contracted with S 1/2 equal to Sij 1/2.
Forget how you define the Frobenius norm.
I I know that's the L2 norm, but I don't remember how you define the Frobenius norm.
I think it's defined as the square root of the trace of S transpose S.
Square root of a trace of S transpose S?
You're right.
But the trace of S is zero. And this is not.
Of S transpose S.
Oh, of a, the, okay, the trace of S transpose S. Yeah, I don't know. But this is the L2 norm. That I do know.
Okay.
But it could be very well that it coincides with this other norm. This is also an invariant. So just like the trace, these two things are invariants. Okay, that and again, that's another reason why they're so popular, they're so much used, and why people like to define things in those planes, because P and the norm of S will not be affected by any rotation. Or by a change of axis, or anything like that. So the reason why we call this guy J2 is because there's something called a J2 invariant, which is defined as 1/2 S squared, or if you will, 1/2 S double contracted with S. So if you just substitute here in the classic form that sometimes you see in textbooks, but we won't really use here. You have F as a function of sigma and kappa equals 2 square root J2 minus kappa. Okay, and so this is hence the name J2, and this guy kappa will be related to sigma y, or the yield strength. And now let's be more precise in 1D stress. So in the bar problem that we used at the beginning to motivate things, we kept talking about this guy sigma. Something that confuses people sometimes is that the whole plasticity simulation or modeling that we were doing before is one in which a state of stress looks like this. Okay? Be careful, because this is not equivalent to the one-dimensional strain state that looks like this. Okay? They're not the same. The formulation of plasticity is done in a 1D stress state. Okay. So be careful. This will become more apparent later. In the problems we're doing here, it doesn't matter. But this is a distinction that sometimes confuses people.
Is it because as we pull along, let's say the one axis, we have due to the Poisson's effect strength?
Absolutely, yeah. So this will yield a sigma 2-2, an epsilon 2-2 and an epsilon 3-3. This is not the same thing. So, okay. So the elastic domain, E bar, closed domain, is one in which sigma belongs to R6. Well, sorry, that's ahead of me. Sigma such that sigma belongs to R6, and F evaluated for every sigma and kappa is less than or equal to zero. So this is the 6x1 vector space. You can also do it in R3 if you're speaking of a 3x1 principal stress space. Okay? Doesn't really matter. Whether you're doing the full space or the principal stress space, sigma belongs to whatever space you're talking about, being R3 or R6. But this has to be true all the time. The F evaluated for sigmas, either the full sigma or the principal stress sigma, has to be less than or equal to sigma. So this defines a boundary, as we will see later on. Okay? Did you talk about convexity? All right, so then people define convexity. Okay, we'll do that quickly. So convexity is an extremely important property because, think about it, if you don't have convexity, you can go from an elastic state to another elastic state going through an infinite number of inelastic states. And that just doesn't make any physical sense. In reality, what usually happens is you go from an elastic state through a plastic state, unless there's some sort of unloading that brings you back to some elastic state. So convexity makes this concept of, okay, you have to go through a certain rational level of states very, very clear. Okay, so here's the classic example of something convex is a balloon, right? So the boundaries defined by my E bar, so this is my elastic domain. Somewhere in that domain, I have some state sigma 1, some state sigma 2, right? And if I join the two with a straight line or with a linear combination of the two, every point along that line must be within E bar. Okay, that's convexity. So this is convex. On the other hand, if I have something like this, and I have some sigma 1, sigma 2 point, and I join them with a straight line, so this is my E bar. Okay, I have a number of points outside of E bar. This is non-convex. Cannot allow that, right? I go from elastic to plastic, back to elastic in a monotonic or linearly, or a linear combination of the two, and that just doesn't make physical sense. Okay, so in the past, there used to be models of plasticity that were non-convex. Okay, there was a famous Rose model that looked very similar to this. Okay, and then people started to understand that this couldn't be. They were having a lot of computational issues with those models. And then, okay, people understood that convexity was something that they needed to enforce in their model. Okay, so the test on convexity is very simple. We're going to be doing that test a lot in this class, okay, for many models. So you take sigma 1 and sigma 2 such that they belong to this E bar, okay? And then you say that E bar is convex if sigma star, which is a linear combination of these two states, is also, so let's just go here, in E bar. So it's just the compact way of what we saw here graphically, right? So I pick any sigma star, which is a linear combination of sigma 1 and sigma 2, which are themselves in E bar. And if sigma star is always in E bar for any n, then you're in business, right? Okay, so you can show that S star, so if you have a linear combination of sigma star, S star follows the same combination. And I invite you to show yourself that. But that's true. Okay, then you then have F evaluated for sigma 1 kappa. By definition, this will be less than or equal to 0. F evaluated sigma 2 kappa is less than or equal to 0, right? Because those two are told to be, are said by definition to be in E bar. So they must be, when they are evaluated, they must yield Fs that are less than or equal to 0. Okay, and then you always go through the same steps when you do an evaluation of convexity. You just go through the triangle inequality to prove your point. So the one that really matters here is F of sigma star kappa. You are curious as to whether this is true, right? If that's true, then it's convex. So F of sigma star kappa is absolutely equal to, well, sigma, the L2 norm of S star minus kappa, which is equal to the L2 norm of this linear combination, right? Okay, and then you use the triangle inequality, right? It says that this L2 norm can be just written as this. Then you take out the n and the n 1 minus n, because they have no business in the L2 norm, really. They just scale the L2 norm. Oops. Then you use the classic trick of writing 1, or k in this case as kn, right, plus k times 1 minus n, right? So k equals nk plus 1 minus nk, right? So, and you spread the terms, you know, you let one of them act here, and let the other one go here. Okay. And this is F of sigma 1 kappa, which you know is less than 0, or less than or equal to 0. And this is F of sigma 2 kappa, which is less than or equal to 0. N is positive. 1 minus N is positive. So this whole thing has to be less than or equal to 0. Has to be. Therefore, E is convex.
Okay.
And EF of sigma star kappa is always less than or equal to 0. So you can't possibly have it otherwise.
Okay.
We'll do this many times for many models. Okay, it's a classic test that people do. Are you comfortable with this? Yeah? No complaints?
So, I'm a little confused as to why this shows that E bar is always convex.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I was expecting that you'd have to, you know, for all sigma 1 and sigma 2 inside E bar,
right.
Run the tests.
Right.
Okay.
But you just did that. Because there's nothing special about sigma 1 and sigma 2. It's here.
Yeah. Okay, but it's actually, you have to look over all combinations of sigma 1 and sigma 2.
Well, we just did that. So the only thing you have to ensure is that they are in E bar.
Mm-hmm.
If they are in we didn't make any assumptions about their value.
Mm-hmm.
So we said just they are in E bar, and the way we show that they are in E bar is that these Fs,
mm-hmm.
right, are less
okay.
than or equal to 0.
I just want to make sure, I can imagine in the case of the non-vex case, picking a sigma 1 and a sigma 2 and having it be, like, just drop it down vertically, and then you pass this test for a given sigma 1 and sigma 2, but your E-bar is not actually convex.
So you're thinking of this case?
Yeah, say that. So I just wanted to make sure that I understand correctly that, because if I pick a sigma 1 and a sigma 2, running through this test, it would say it's convex, but in reality, I could still have some other picture.
It's a local test, right? It's not a global test.
Yeah, that's interesting.
That's what I was saying. I was imagining I have to check all possible combinations of sigma 1 and sigma 2 and E bar. Otherwise, I could potentially get a false positive. Or a false, no. It could be return a convex when it's not actually convex.
Yeah. So, I guess you have to see this as being applicable for any sigma 1 and sigma 2. I mean, that's how I interpret it. But in the cases when you have indeed non-convexity, it shows pretty quickly. I mean, it breaks the whole machinery, mm-hmm. breaks down. You cannot, in general, say that. So I guess what this statement is this is evaluating the entire space. So it's evaluating all points along this line and all points along that line, without necessarily eliminating any possibility of you know, all it's saying is any sigma 1, any sigma 2 that are inside of E. So
in theory, that's what should happen, but I feel like numerically, you know, it would be kind of hard to test every...
Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. When you do it numerically, there's no way you can tell. There's no way
right.
you can tell. But when the non-convexity, when the convexity test fails analytically, it just you cannot go through this machinery analytically when the thing is not convex. When it is convex, yeah, you're right. You can think of or even in this case, you can think of another sigma 2 where you will pass the convexity test for that particular case. But in the analytical case, when you can pick any sigma 1 or sigma 2, right? Because this, the way to really read this is to say for any sigma 1, sigma 2, right? And then the thing falls apart when you don't have it. Yeah, so you will have some sigma 1, sigma 2 where you will pass the test, but not for any. And this holds for any. Okay, cool. Good point. I hadn't thought of that. Good. Okay, so let's keep going. So you consider, then you go into rotations. Did you do rotations?
No, not yet.
Okay. So you take F. So we're evaluating this F of sigma kappa, which is, okay, that's our main function. Let's consider this a constant. For now, at least. Some number. Okay. So recall that S equals sigma minus sigma B, or sigma minus, the way you see it written many times is P times the identity, right? Or you see it written as sigma minus 1/3 trace of sigma times Zn. So this is the way you see S written many times. So one can show, and I hope you do, when you go home and show this, that the L2 norm of S boils down to sigma 1 minus sigma 2 squared plus sigma 1 minus sigma 3 squared plus sigma 2 minus sigma 3 squared, all of that square root. And the way to prove yourself that this is true is just take sigma in its diagonal form. Right, and then show yourself that S is then, it goes down to 2/3 sigma 1 minus 1/3 sigma 2 plus sigma 3. This guy here becomes 2/3 sigma 2 minus 1/3 sigma 1 plus sigma 3. And finally, this guy here becomes 2/3 sigma 3 minus 1/3 sigma 2 plus sigma 1. Just to make it evident. Okay, take the L2 norm of that, which is essentially, you know, this squared plus that squared plus that squared. Right, take the square root. And you'll get this. Okay? This is the square. Okay? Play with it. You'll see that. Everybody else is zero. So it's 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay? So it's okay. Play with it. You can also look at the fact that sigma 1 equals sigma 2 equals sigma 3 equals 0 will mean that F is less than 0. So if you evaluate F at the 0 stress state, that is an F that is less than or equal to 0, right? Because essentially, S the norm of S is zero, and all you get is kappa, which is positive. We haven't said that, but let's say it now, times a minus sign, right? So this is less than zero, right, by definition. Okay, so that just means that the origin is included in the elastic region, this thing that we're calling E bar, right? And you will actually see that every time sigma 1 equals sigma 2 equals sigma 3, not equal to 0, even then, you are in the elastic domain. Take it equal to some alpha, sigma 1 minus sigma 2, 0, sigma 1 minus sigma 3, that's 0, sigma 2 minus sigma 3, that's also 0. So that also yields an S norm 0. So a hydrostatic state, whether it is at the origin or anywhere along, of course, we already erased it. So this was sigma 1 equals sigma 2. This was sigma 3. This is the hydrostatic axis. This is my pi plane. We haven't defined what this elastic region is yet, but we do know that any state along this line is within that elastic state, including this point, including any point along the other end, anywhere along a line that is parallel to the hydrostatic axis and goes through the origin, you are in the elastic region.
So maybe that also makes important the hydrostatic axis. Some models, or many models, have symmetry. The gel surface has symmetry with respect to the...
Right.
And when you don't have symmetry, like in the case of the Mohr-Coulomb, for instance, mm-hmm. You have to calibrate it, like in the case of the Drucker-Prager, mm-hmm. and you try to make it upper or down, mm-hmm. something like that.
Yeah, so the hydrostatic axis plays a very important role because the entire geometry of your yield surface will be described relative to that in many cases, okay? So in this case, this model includes... We don't know what the elastic region is going to be yet, but we do know that it includes the full hydrostatic axis as long as kappa, right, is greater than or equal to zero. So for any kappa greater than or equal to zero, that's true, right?
So this means that for a solid, let's say, if we are given a certain yield stress in the x, y, and z direction, we can apply hydrostatic loads exceeding the yield stress. We know we are still going to be in the elastic region.
Exactly. So this model says apply any pressure you want. Yeah. You're always elastic. Yeah. Because the way that the model is going to induce yielding, and you can see it there, is through some deviatory stress. Any volumetric stress, it's irrelevant for the model. So that already starts to give you a sense that no matter where you are in the hydrostatic axis, you're always elastic, and that the model has no way of telling whether you're at 100 or at 10 or at 10,000. For the model, it means the same. So if you were to sketch this elastic region, you would say it has to probably not care relative to where you are in the hydrostatic axis. So you probably have something that, for any point in the hydrostatic axis, it always has the same value of strength. So yeah, so you're starting to get that sense already. And that would be true once we do these rotations that we're gonna do. Yeah, in fact, so that was my next point, that any So, okay, so this means that the hydrostatic axis is contained, fully contained in E bar. And it also means that if I evaluate F, so if you look at the form of F, if I evaluate F for any alpha plus, any sigma 1 plus alpha, any sigma 2 plus alpha, any sigma 3 plus alpha, doesn't matter as long as I am consistent with that shift. Okay, this is always I don't know, so I'm going to erase it. I have it in my notes. I have some sort of translation with respect to alpha, but I cannot make any sense of this right now, so I'm not going to say it.
Isn't that the same thing as saying it's always contained in E bar?
What?
Sigma 1 plus alpha, sigma 2 plus alpha, sigma 3 plus alpha, so you're always hydrostatic?
As long as sigma 1 equals sigma 2 equals sigma 3.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So if this is true, then any shift, so if sigma 1 equals sigma 2 equals sigma 3, so you can say that, then for any alpha, it follows that F of sigma 1 plus alpha, sigma 2 plus alpha, sigma 3 plus alpha, kappa, is also going to be less than or equal to 0. That you can say, yeah.
Wouldn't it also be true that if you have a sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, such that it's in the elastic region, even if it's not necessarily hydrostatic, but as long as it's still in the elastic region, that if you shift them all by the same amount, then you'd still be in the elastic
so
region.
So say that again?
So if you have a stress state,
yeah. Sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3.
Yeah, that's elastic.
Yes.
If you shift them all by the same number, that won't change the deviatoric stress at all, I don't think. Right? And so it's still elastic in that case. That would be what you're saying?
Probably. So let's test that. Can we?
Well, I mean, they're all different.
Yeah,
so if you all add alpha to everything.
It should follow, right? So, okay, so then in general, So maybe that's what I was trying to say here, and I just can't see it right now. So if F of sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, kappa, less than or equal to 0, then for any alpha, for any shift, it should also follow. And I think you're right, because it's like just plugging it in here, right? The alphas will disappear. And then all you will have is F of sigma. And if that was less than or equal to 0, then it follows that this is also true. So for any shift in alpha, but then that has a geometric connotation, which leads you to believe that this needs to be a cylinder. And my mind is failing me right now. I just can't see that. So if you see it.
Why would you write this? Sigma 1 plus alpha is, let's say, the principal stress in one direction.
Right. Yeah.
And that could be coming from, I don't know, another distribution of stresses, sigma 1, 1, sigma 1, 2, and so on.
Right.
Which may not necessarily be related to the previous one.
Right.
As long as I'm guessing we get the same shift in every principal component.
Right.
But it is a cylinder, right?
Yeah, I know that. we're going to discover that it is a cylinder. But what I cannot see is how from this is true. I mean, it follows that if this is true, this is true. That there's no question about that. But then in my notes, I have that as a consequence, this is a cylinder. And I just can't see that right now.
Because that's a movement. That's a movement along a line that's parallel to the hydrostatic axis. So it basically says that, like, it's a cylinder that's centered at the hydrostatic axis, and you can move, like, along that thing.
So you see it?
Yeah.
Okay, because I don't know. That's okay. I'm just going to write it for those of you that later will be able to see this geometrically, because right now I cannot see it, okay? So let's see. So what this is saying is, if you are at any point, let's try to do the easy case. Let's say you're in the hydrostatic axis. So if you're in the hydrostatic axis, and then, well, if you move by an alpha amount, everyone, you would continue to be in the hydrostatic axis, wouldn't you?
Right.
Right. So that's not fun. Then there is another point, let's say here. Ah, now I see it. So if you're here and you move an alpha, if you make an alpha shift, you always make a shift that is parallel to the hydrostatic axis. That's what you're trying to say. Yeah. So this is parallel to this. Yes, then I see it. Right, so you can continue indefinitely. So you see that? So you can be at any point in the stress space and make an alpha change in that state of stress. That means that you will move along, you know, a direction that is parallel to the hydrostatic axis, and that will always be inside the yield surface. So that, okay, that means that this thing has to be a cylinder, pretty much, right? Because you never touch, if you were in, and you keep going along the hydrostatic axis, no matter for any value of sigma, you must have a cylinder here. But even then, okay, I don't quite see the cylinder yet. But it would be a cylinder, you'll see. Okay, let's keep going. The way to see the cylinder is to do the following rotations, which will become extremely important in plasticity. So I suggest that you make them part of your daily routine. So if you look at sigma 1, sigma 3, sigma 2, and I'm sorry, this is sigma 2 in my notes. I just want to follow my notes with this. I want to follow the formal rotations. And imagine taking this axis and rotating them about sigma 2. So that's the first rotation we're going to apply, about sigma 2. So the sigma 3 comes underneath the hydrostatic axis. So we move this guy by 45 degrees. So my new sigma 3 is here. I'm going to call it sigma 3 prime. And therefore, my new sigma 1 is here, sigma 1 prime, also shifted 45 degrees. And my sigma 2 prime is the same. Okay? So I have a new set of axes. They have just been rotated about the sigma 2 axis by 45 degrees. Okay? So far, so good? So if you imagine the hydrostatic axis coming out of a plane, the projection of that hydrostatic axis from the top will coincide with sigma 3. Sigma 3 prime. This rotation corresponds to sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3 being equal to root 2 over 2, 0, root 2 over 2, 0, 1, 0, minus root 2 over 2, 0, root 2 over 2, multiplied by sigma 1 prime, sigma 2 prime, sigma 3 prime, not Q, prime. Okay? let's call this guy the A rotation. Okay, so A is a rotation matrix that takes you from a sigma axis to the sigma prime axis, and vice versa. Okay, now let's do another rotation. So take now the sigma 1 prime, the sigma 2 prime, and the sigma 3 prime. Okay, now you take the prime axis system. And what we're going to do is we're going to lift sigma 3 prime by complement of theta, so that we make sigma 3 prime align with the hydrostatic axis. So remember that we had this sigma 1 equal sigma 2, this was sigma 3. Here we had the hydrostatic axis, and we said this was theta. So right now, sigma 3, so if you want, this is sigma 3 prime, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to lift sigma 3 prime by that, by the complement of theta, so that we will have the sigma 3 double prime exactly aligned with the hydrostatic axis. Then this guy would have to shift and so on. Okay, so we have rotated the axis, you know, to make this coincide with the shadow of the hydrostatic axis, and then we have lifted it so that the sigma 3. So eventually what we've done is essentially make the sigma 3 axis be the hydrostatic axis. Okay? And then everybody else has followed. So essentially here is sigma 3 and sigma 1 and sigma 2 have no choice but to follow. Okay. So essentially, sigma 1 and sigma 2 are in what plane?
Pi plane.
The pi plane, right? Yeah, exactly. So anywhere you want to describe on the pi plane, you will describe it with sigma 1, sigma 2. Anything that you want to describe in terms of advancement or movement along the hydrostatic axis is going to be your sigma 3. Okay? So it's a clever realignment to make everything collapse to that. So this shift is theta or 90 minus theta. Therefore, I believe this is theta, right? Because this will be theta, this will be 90 minus theta, yeah, this is theta. So this is sigma 3 double prime. So this is a rotation in which, hold on, sorry guys, my jet lag is getting the best out of me. I'm holding sigma 1 prime, and I'm rotating things with respect to sigma 1 prime. So my rotation is like this. So this guy is the guy that's rotating. It turned out that this was sigma, but I think that's confusing. This is theta, or 90 minus theta, right? This amount. So this we label sigma 2 double prime. This is sigma 3 double prime. This is equal to sigma 1 double prime. Nothing happened to sigma 1. Okay. And I can write that rotation. So rotation matrix that looks like 1, 0, 0, because nothing happened to this guy. 0 root 2 thirds, 1 over root 3, 0 minus 1 over root 3, minus
root 2/3. And call this guy the B matrix. Also a rotation. So essentially, the intermediate one doesn't matter. Sigma equals A times B times sigma double bracket. Okay, and let's put it in curly brackets to highlight the fact this is the vector sigma, the principal directions. Okay? So all I've done is rotate things. This rotation, by the way, is about 35.3 degrees. Right? Because we said that theta was like 54 something, right? 54.7, right? So this guy is 35.3. Now, given all of these rotations, you can show, please do this, that the L2 norm of S in the rotated axis is nothing but sigma 1 double prime squared plus sigma 2 double prime squared square root. Just like we had said before, that sigma 1, sigma 2, we're going to describe everything that happened on that pi plane, and essentially what happens on that pi plane is always going to be a measure of S, the norm. Okay, so this starts to give you a feel for what's going on, and therefore, F, right, belongs or becomes sigma 1 double prime squared plus sigma 2 double prime squared square rooted minus kappa. That nothing happened to that. This, when it is equal to 0, right, this is the equation of a semicircle. With a radius kappa, right? That I can't, even you and I can see that right now. Okay. So you have, so let's do a couple of sketches that I like to always do. Here. So if you look at the pi plane, if you look at a picture that we're actually towards the end of class, so I'm gonna do it slowly so that we get the full picture. So if you look at the original sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. My hydrostatic axis will be pointing out of the picture. Right? So this is what we're going to be calling HA. Right? It's that line coming, sticking out of the picture. My sigma 3 double prime is that line as well. We made that decision by design. Okay, I'm just going to move these because, as usual, I've gotten in the way of the sketch. So this is that point, which is sigma 3 double prime. Then we, so use the right-hand side rule. So if you stuck your finger and align it with the hydrostatic axis, right, these two guys will have to rotate with that rotation, right? So sigma 1 double prime will end up here. And this guy would be sigma 2 double prime. You see that?
Or, no, it's not equal.
It's not equal.
It's comma.
Yeah. You're right.
It looks as if it's equal, but it's not. It's been sigma 2 is covering sigma 2 double prime. Sigma 2 double prime has gone to the back. See that? Yes or no? Say if you don't see it.
You say that again, sorry.
So,
I missed that one.
So let's do it like this. So let's see if I can do it the way I teach my undergraduate students. So let's do the right hand rule. So sigma 3 is pointing in this direction, my thumb, and my fingers curl in the direction that span the plane defined by sigma 1, sigma 2. So now, so right now things are like this. Then I rotate this guy here. So now my fingers curl in the direction spanned by the plane defined by sigma 1, sigma 2. Right? So here's what my sigma 1 is now. And spans this plane, the blackboard, essentially. But it's not exactly the blackboard because I didn't just do this, I did this and that. I did this, and then I did that. So in the first one, sigma 1 double prime rotated. So that's the one that moves this guy here. And then in the second one, this guy stays fixed, right? He didn't move. And sigma 2 double prime goes to the back. Now you see it? So sigma 2 is hiding sigma 2 double prime. So they're like this. Yeah. Okay. Let's try to do another one here. So if we do this other sketch that we had, where this was sigma 1, sigma 2 equal. This is the biplane. This is an understanding axis. This was, sigma 3 by coincidence. This guy here, let's do it one step at a time. What is this guy in the rotated axis? What is this guy?
Sigma 2 double prime.
Sigma 2 double prime. Sigma 3 double, and sigma 1 double prime is sticking out of the board. All right, and this is the biplane. Okay, now coming back here. The semicircle is in the sigma 1, sigma 2 plane, always, and it has a radius kappa. So you have something that looks like a circle. Okay, as best as I can draw it, with a radius kappa. Sigma 1 double prime, sigma 2 double prime. Okay. And then I extend, and then that circle extends infinitely along the hydrostatic axis. So when I plot the other classic plot that people plot, which is the sigma 3 double prime, in other words, the hydrostatic axis on the x. And now this one here becomes what? What should be the other rational axis? Well, either sigma 1 or double prime or sigma 2 double prime, but people usually pick sigma 2 double prime. Okay. Then sigma 1 double prime is sticking out of the page, right? On that plane, your surface, whether it's positive or negative, it doesn't matter. This distance is kappa. This is F equals zero. This is F equals zero. This is F equals zero. Ah, and it also goes this way. So it's a cylinder. So now, let's try to draw it in 3D, and may God bless us, given my drawing abilities.
That's a quick question.
Yes.
Why did you say semicircle?
It's just a circle. I think that they call it a circle in the formal version, when this is not square rooted and this is square. There's something to do with that, I think, in mathematics, but I cannot remember. It's just a circle.
Can we start to make a relationship between kappa and some form of like a tau max?
Oh yeah, we will.
Okay.
Yeah, we will. We will. And sigma y and all this stuff, yeah. We will. Okay, so let's just finish the geometry. Sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. Because of all the rotations, this is sigma 1 double prime. Sigma 2 double prime is hiding behind sigma 2. Okay? And sigma 3 double prime is sticking out of the page. Again, this looks a lot like what we drew before. Now let's try to do the same thing. Sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. Here's my cylinder. Here's the hydrostatic axis. This distance always kappa. Okay. This is solid. And this cylinder elongates infinitely along the hydrostatic axis. And then we're going to use this later and have, we will always have a normal to that yield surface, which will be defined as df, the sigma, or the gradient of f, with respect to sigma. Okay, so when you are coding, I highly recommend that you always code plots of your function evaluations, at least in these two planes, along with the projection of your yield surface on those two planes. And make sure that every yield stress, every point is always on your yield surface as you are evolving. Anything, or at least inside. But you can catch your code plotting outside sometimes, and you know that that's an error. Or you know that you should be getting a hydrostatic response, and all of a sudden you see a point here, which is not hydrostatic. Or you think that maybe you're prescribing your pressure, and you know that it's 100 kPa, and all of a sudden your code is responding with pressures of 200. So you can catch an enormous amount of errors just by plotting on those two planes. And then, after that, plot in 3D. But it's very difficult to see things in 3D. You know, you get a point here. Is that inside or outside of your surface? very difficult to see. Okay. So do this, make this a practice, okay? So that you always know what's going on with your codes, and it becomes even more important when the model gets more complicated. Okay, I had more, but I think it's better if we stop there and do the formulation of the model next week. Okay.